Wonderful. Well, it's our privilege in this next session to listen to one of the business people in our country. And I must say, it's quite a privilege to introduce this afternoon to you the next speaker, as in my opinion, I would rate him as one of the top business people in South Africa. That's my humble opinion. I've struggled to drop the part of Francois, so I don't want to show disrespect, but Francois van Niekerk is going to be speaking to us for the next couple of minutes. He's written these two books. He's basically written the one book, Doing Business with Purpose. I want to highly recommend this book. If you haven't read it, it's available at the back. And with that, there is the little booklet with it, Doing the Good Giving Guide. The Good Giving Guide was established about about two years ago, where they help companies with a guideline of how to give. From your company perspective, how to get involved in giving. And they might, Francois might touch on the aspect of how to get involved with them, and we'll get into some of those questions a bit later on. But it's been a privilege for me to have known Francois for a couple of years, had two or three interviews with him, and it's always when you're here, you can get another hour of his time. It's just a fantastic privilege. So Francois van Niekerk, let's welcome him. Please do come to the front. Thank you.
Sort out the picture just now. When I sat down at the back and listened to Steve, and I then made a duck for it, but they closed the gate, so it seems to be I couldn't get out the gate. So hopefully I'm a lot different from Steve, and I don't talk as well, but the message is not from me. And how are you going to get something out of this afternoon? Quite seriously, you will get something if you look past me at the man who made it all happen, the being, the supreme being. So please just look past me. It's not very difficult. I'm not a big guy. That's why I came up and stood on the podium here. This you don't see me. And Marno sort of plucked me out of retirement a little bit, and I'm trying to remain on top of my game. I've now started learning how to text, because I've seen when you move into these retirement villages, you better be slightly different. And my homework showed me that these people like organizing little card games and stuff, and then the code is, if there's something to eat, then they text BYOT, which is bring your own teeth. And another thing I picked up in my homework, moving into that phase of my life, is when you want to get up and go, then you text again GGPBL, which is gotta go, pacemaker battery low. So I'm trying to stay relevant, and so I'm going to try and tell you simply what happened to me in my life, my business life, which started at age 40. I was in corporate life for 15 years, and then at some point the corporation I worked for, I just knew I had to leave for various reasons which we don't really have time to go into now. And so what happened to me when I started in business at age 40, how I responded to it, what God did, and what I can now testify about, for you to take out of it whatever you wish to take. And what is important is in John 5:31, God says clearly, if you testify about yourself, your testimony is not true, not valid, not useful. So I'm quite aware of that. So let me say also that I was forced, in a way, by my young colleagues to write the story down. So I took a whole year in 2015 and wrote the book. And I'm openly going to plug the book for the simple reason it is no benefit to me whatsoever. It is simply part of the testimony. Every few cents that is made goes back into the trust and towards the kingdom. So it's difficult for me to portray to you what happened in 37 years. It's all in the book. So if you want to know more, please feel free. I'm fairly certain that you will find it a worthwhile investment, even to just give to somebody. So, okay, we have a slight challenge. It's can we put a bit of light off, or is it not possible? Okay. Let's see if you can. I don't need to be on film at all. So if you want to put that off, it's fine with me. It says there, for those of you who can't see it, a new business perspective. So let's say it's simply a new business perspective. And it says at the bottom, share with generations to come for them to be encouraged and put their faith in God. Psalm 78. So that is my purpose here, simply to share with you, to be of service to you, and to be an instrument in His hand, because He is to do the job, not me. So, let's see. Okay. That looks promising. It's just a bit too high, right? Good. So, I'm going to try and go through it fairly quickly to give you time for questions and discussion, because there's a lot of value in that. And you can ask me anything you want. So, the first title there is Discovering a Partner. I put a partner, quote unquote, because woe be for me to think that I can be a partner of God. But let's say, just to communicate, Discovering a Partner. Point one, I started in business in 1980. And those of you who know Pretoria, it was literally in a back room at the Rondalia building opposite the City Hall. And I had no capital whatsoever, and I was waiting for an order in September 1980. I was trying to survive month by month by month, and in September I could only pay the three people working there if I got a certain order, and I could take that to the bank and say, now you must give me money to pay the salaries. The customer phoned and said, we're going to buy the stuff, but not now, 6 months from now, with a new capital budget. That's how corporations work. And I knew I was dead. I just knew it was the end. Bankruptcy was imminent. So, point three, I asked the customer if I can come there and plead. I didn't say plead, a good businessman doesn't do that. It's just the previous slide, sorry. And on the way there, I stood on the pavement, and I didn't have a very good relationship with God at that point. Does one ever have, or is it a growing situation that you must keep on working on it? But I was a second Sunday Christian, if I can put it like that. So, I felt I was so deep in trouble that I had to offer God something. Now, you know, I can hear just from a few minutes sitting in the back there, you know that's a nonsense offer. To offer God anything, to get something from Him in return, I do not believe in prosperity theology at all. And I learned later on that God humored me by, I don't know if he even considered this offer. Because to offer someone 30% of a bankrupt company, you do not need to be an accountant at all. So that is part of the humor of God, that he tolerated the offer. And What happened then was a completely unexpected outcome that I'll give you a taste of just now. And what is important is right at the bottom, if you can move it up a little bit. My grace is sufficient, my power made perfect in weakness, 2 Corinthians 12. And then, more importantly, a promise you make to God. God, I'll give you 30% of this nothing. If you make it something, it's still 30%. Better, that's a promise you make. Better not to vow than to make a vow and not fulfill it, the word says, quite clearly. What I discovered over the past 37 years, and it took me too long, and I plead with you for you not to waste time and to realize, to take decades for you to realize this simple fact. If you're a child of God, you have a key to His power. If you are the son of Joe Brown, you have a key to His fatherhood. It's very simple. And it's so simple that for some reason people don't understand it. There must be more. It must be more difficult. I don't know why. God's message is simple, but powerful. So what I experienced was when a customer said, listen, not now, 6 months from now, it was like a physical door slammed in my face. And I only realized many years later the example of a door as a keyhole. And if you're a child of God, you have access to His power. You have a key. It's not a physical key, obviously, but you can pray. You can ask Him. You will receive. So the power of the key, what I experienced was, one, acknowledge your own weakness and place your faith. The only thing I can tell you to somehow exonerate my stupid deed of offering Him something, to expect something in return, is at least I acknowledged my own weakness. I said to Him on the pavement, in what Versace Street, I said to Him, I'm dead, the business is gone, I can't make it work, please help me. And I placed my faith, I'm stretching it a bit now, by saying, I'm offering you 30% if you help me. So at least I placed my faith. That's just my, it may not be theological, I don't know, but it's just the way I experience it. I received grace. And you know, grace is undeserved favor. Thirdly, He tested me a lot. 90% of the time, because I was doing my own thing, I kept on missing the point that here it is. He helped me immediately because I got to the customer and I said, okay. I thought it was my last cup of coffee, but let's enjoy it anyway, it's free. So I said, fine, you want this stuff? Yes, he said, as I said on the phone. And I heard myself say, can I rent it to you? He said, that's a great idea. I have money in my rental budget. I'll rent it. How much is it? I had no idea because we had never rented anything before and there was no policy for rental. But that was something to work with. So in the end, it turned out even better than I thought. But let me move on to give us time for discussion. So, point three, let me just say, some people say, okay, big deal. You can just as well say it was your own plan. One, I know it wasn't my own plan. I had no plan. Believe me or not, it was not my own plan. Two, the way that God's hand came upon the business from that moment on is something I still do not understand to this day, truly. But I know, like I know the Bible is the truth, I know. That is, I went to Bible school for 1 year and that taught me unequivocally the Bible is the truth. So I know that God's hand is on the business. Deservedly, no. And I like to think there might be one person sitting here today who needed to hear this message today. That is why he put me through this 37 years of walk with him, so that you can hear it. It's just something that I motivate myself to get up 4 o'clock in the morning and catch a flight to go and talk to people in Durban or here or wherever. So, point four, grow the relationship with him. Exactly like with the women here obviously don't have children, they certainly look too young. But if you have children, you know. The more the kid works on his relationship with you, the more you are wanting to smother him or her with love and with whatever he or she needs at the right time. That's important. So grow your relationship, get perspective, and I'll give you a perspective right after this of how I came to understand in my own mind who God really is. And point five, simply realize the power of the key. If you are his child, you've got the key. Full stop. And what is important at the bottom, if you can see there, the person without the Spirit, says Paul in 1 Corinthians 2:14, the person without the Spirit does not accept these things that come from the Spirit of God, but considers them foolishness. So, nobody here in this room, but if you go back and you talk to your friend or somebody tomorrow and say, ah, there was this old guy there, he talked a lot of things, or you are nice to us, me, and you said, yeah, it was a good message. He says, yeah, all right, another Bible puncher who thinks you can misuse God for business. What I want to show you next is, you can't see it very well there. If you Google, not right now, but if you Google the Sombrero Galaxy, since Mexico is much in the news these days in Steve's country, the Sombrero Galaxy, the Mexican hat, Sombrero, you will check these facts for yourself. There were two chaps talking on the radio here a year or so ago, two Americans. The one was Anton Kukumur and the other one was Yapi van Sail. Two Americans. The one is the head of the Mars project and the other one, Anton Kukumur, is the head of the Hubble telescope. And he was enthusiastic about two things that interested me. The creation was 13.7 billion years ago. So I went back to the office and I worked this out and I had a clever friend check it. If you take the creation and you condense it into 1 year, 12 months, and we are now at the end of the year. The creation was 1 January. The Karoo defrosted in September. Animals appeared 23 December, I think it was, and so on and so on. Christ was born 4.2 seconds ago. 2,000 years, 4 seconds in 1 year. That helped me to understand when the Dominus says, God is. Suddenly I understood. God is. It's not a question of was or will be or something is going to happen. He simply is. He controls time. And the second thing was, Anton Kukumur was born in Welkom and can't, he carried on about the Sombrero Galaxy. Now, what you can't see so well there, it's a magnificent speck of the creation. It is 50,000 light years across. Now, that means nothing. But try and understand if I say to you that the sun is 8 minutes, 8 light minutes from us, the sun, 8 minutes. This creation is 29 million light years away. There's nobody in this room who can quickly grab that, and I'm still trying to come to terms with what it means. The sun 8 minutes, 29 million light years. It's 50,000 light years across. It consists of millions of galaxies, not stars, galaxies. And it moves away from us at 1,000 kilometers a second, which means the creation is still in progress. That's the good news. Don't worry, it's still in progress. God is still expanding, not imploding. So, what has this got to do with what we're talking about here this afternoon? We can turn over this. It's a simple way that I try to come to terms with. Look at what God is doing, and who is He? It's just something that interested me, because isn't it true that any creator is much bigger than his creation? So it somehow resonated with me. So that helped me to understand when I'm now going to try to you in the next slide to explain to you what God did 37 years ago with a little bankrupt outfit in the back room, literally in the back room, and is now an international conglomerate with about 200 companies that can be divided in 10 industry sectors. And the signature companies is on the board. But before I brag about the companies, because I brag on his behalf, if I may say it like that, I know it's not me. There's no way that I had it in me to do anything in this, not even vaguely. I know that. So what is important to me, may I please point out, at the top, in red, how do we view the business? Me, there are 1,500 people working there. Now, when the top management and so on sit and think about these things, how do we see ourselves? Simply as stewards in amazement at what God is doing. Because the 30% worried me no end, and I eventually turned it around to 70%. So we registered the trust 35 years ago, which is independent. It's not the Funicular Trust or anything like that. It's an independent trust, the Mergon Foundation, and Mergon is two Greek words meaning expansion of the kingdom. So expansion of the area of the flock. So stewards, we are stewards of what belongs to Him. Because if you have 70% of anything, you are the controlling shareholder. And it took us many decades to get around to realizing that if a human being owned 70%, we would have a red telephone and a special parking for the human being. But if it's God, who's not physically visible, then somehow it took us years to realize we better honor Him as the controlling shareholder, which is what we're now doing. And since we started doing that, everything works wonderfully. So, and at the bottom, if we can just quickly go to the bottom, that's the second important thing. Use the things of the world as if not engrossed in them, says the Bible, 1 Corinthians 7. So, if you're successful in business, there's a lot of money, and that's fine. But what do you do with it? Use the things of the world as if not engrossed in them. Don't hang yourself up with money. Well, that's a literal translation for Afrikaans, sorry. So, if we move down a little bit, I'm just going to quickly read to you in one sentence each to give you some taste of what the group now consists of. The companies, the first block on the left is basically technology companies. Infotech was the original business, it's still around. It does smart electricity meters, automated meter reading, and prepaid electricity vending. Mobile Data does trade switch technology to distribute prepaid airtime, a mobile wallet capability, etc. urban eyes. And by the way, the stars on the right of every company indicate one star is South Africa only, two stars is Africa and Europe, basically, and three stars is global. So Urban Eyes is a global company listed on the Australian Stock Exchange. Technology to administer property, remotely monitor equipment, and for communicating with field personnel and service providers. Matic Marine is based in Cape Town, is the world's only retriever and recycler of redundant marine cables. On the picture is one of three ships that we converted here in Cape Town to pick up redundant marine cables worldwide. And I'm going to take just 1 second. We got a project 2 years ago in the North Atlantic, and I asked, sometimes one must ask these questions to show that you're still alive and that you're interested. So I asked, but surely, just tell me, I have a feeling the Titanic sank south of this point. In other words, you know, 2,000 kilometers north of where the Titanic sank. So it's kind of obvious there's lots of icebergs there. They say, no, no, we did our homework. They worked there for months. They never saw an iceberg. It's interesting, the owner of the Titanic, as you know, said, not even God can sink the ship. So he sank it right there with a few words. So, where are we? Then in the property block here, Atterbury and Attack is the listed part of Atterbury, South Africa's premier property group, also in Africa and the European Union and all over Europe now. Listed on the JSE and Mass Real Estate is a British Dominion company that we set up about 6 years ago. It's a prominent listed EU property group active throughout the UK, Germany, Switzerland and Eastern Europe. Listed on the JSE and in Luxembourg. Then on the right, Renewable Energy Holdings has just completed the third of five hydropower stations in the Ash River. Tala Resource Development mines coal for export only, not to sell to Eskom or the Guptas, in Middelburg. 4PL Logistics Group specializing in bulk transport. Then King Price is where Mano spends a lot of time. King Price is the new kid on the insurance block in South Africa, innovative short-term insurer expanding internationally at present. Munich Re has taken a small stake in it. They wanted more, but we're not going to give them more. Then Easy Gym operates 17 gymnasiums in London, Birmingham and Southampton. And finally, Nilo is the world's largest free-flow producer of crocodile skin for the luxury market. Free flow meaning we do not grow the crocodiles in cement pens, but in a free flow natural environment. We make it easy before we slaughter them. Sorry. Now I don't think you're gonna I don't think you're gonna see the rest. But that's just a picture of the CEOs of the major companies. On the left here is a picture of the ship. The hydro station that was just finished in the Ash River in the Free State is next. And King Price is there. I didn't want to show Gideon's car because that would have been different. Then the next, that is a project that Mass Real Estate is doing in the middle of Edinburgh in Scotland. It's three hotels and a lot of retail and I think 105 penthouses in next to the Royal Mile in Edinburgh. And these two guys run Easy Gym. And sorry, you can't see now, but that's a coal pit in Middelburg. We're mining 10 million tons of coal there at the moment. And so on. So how does the whole thing work? The next slide is, at the top you'll see in Latin, Regni Negotia Extendimus, which is simply the kingdom expanded through business. And that is our credo. So it's quite simple. The shareholding is on the right, the Mergon Foundation, which is independent. My family has the right to appoint two trustees with no special voting rights, none. Just two trustees, and then at least another five or more must be independent, not work for the company, nothing. And the Mergon Foundation, the trustee says every cent earned by the Mergon Foundation must go to the kingdom. And I'll tell you how just now. The family still got 15%, my family, and the kids are doing their very best to maneuver it away from me. And management has got 15%. So that is the shareholding structure. If we move down a bit, on the right are the investments I've bragged about. On the left, the 70% of the shareholding owned by the Mergon Foundation produced 105 million rand in the current fiscal year, which ends in July, in June, for kingdom expansion, and there are around 150 organizations. We prefer established organizations that has a proven record of so the you know, we do not throw money at anything. We try and give money and other benefits, which I don't really have time to explain now, but try and help people to network and so maximum kingdom impact is what we try and achieve. And these 140 at the moment, 147 kingdom partners run around, plus or minus a couple of hundred, around 800 projects throughout Africa, increasingly in the Middle East, and in about, they say 100, but let me say in a tenfold on the other countries. So around 800 projects. If we turn to the next slide, I cannot give you an idea of 800 projects in a couple of minutes, but I'm going to show you three or four. So on the top left is some orphans in Durban in safe houses. Orphans that have been devastated sexually, mostly in a home environment, are taken out. And there's a project run by a guy called T. Smith, Lift Project, with the objective of housing 1,000 of these youngsters in houses with a mother and with a school on the same premises and so on. Give them a renewed start to life. On the right, there are 54,000 prisoners still in jails in Rwanda, and we have a project there that assists reconciliation between the convicted guy in pink there and the family members of the people that he butchered 10 years or what ago, a reconciliation project. And at the bottom is Dr. Van Staden from Helderberg project down in Somerset West, delivering a baby in Mozambique, as if there are not enough babies, but now. The next is just another couple of slides to give you some taste. We support the bookship, the Logos Hope, that infiltrates Christianity around the world in countries where Christianity is not welcome, but where books are welcome. And some of the governments don't worry too much about what kind of books, as long as it's books. Working in China, I'm so sorry you can't see that. It's a beautiful picture of a typical Chinese little cart with two guys of project here in South Africa that went there. So let's say that's our secret service in China. And on the left bottom here, you may or may not know that 60% of the world population has no access to the Bible. They cannot read. There is no Bible in their language, or there is, and they can read, but the government of the country do not allow any Christian literature, definitely not the Bible. So, in terms of the spoken word, Davar is one of the projects we support. They have brought the Bible in their own language to 3 million people so far. That's why I say another 3 million. So the final slide, the penultimate slide, is what lessons did we learn? Many, many. But the main ones, if you're successful in business, there's a prosperity trap. Either on the top, you are responsible as to how you deal with money, and then you get benefits, freedom, and joy. If you deal with it responsibly and cap yourself, or at the bottom, or the money curse. Money becomes your boss. You cannot have enough. I want more. I need another Porsche. I need a yacht. I need an aeroplane, and I don't know what else. Next thing you want a mistress, and then the whole thing just goes. So, secondly, we learned success is mostly about serving your own, or success is often about serving your own. If you want to move beyond success and you want to go to significance, then there are three levels we've learned. Significance brings unexpected fulfillment, and there are three items. One, and by the way, should any one or two of you want a copy of the slides, you're more than welcome. There's no copyright. Significance is achieved in three consecutive levels. If you start putting your organization before your own interest every time, you work for an organization, or you own an organization, it's your own company, there are always times when you have to make a decision. Is this good for me or for the company? I'm asking you, I'm almost pleading with you to test it. If you go every time to the best thing for the organization. We have a wonderful example right now. Our government cannot begin to understand that if they serve South Africa's interest before their own political interest, it will be the best for them in the end, for sure. But for some reason, they don't understand it. And many governments don't do. It's not just our government. So, if you can bring yourself to not looking after your own interest, but serve your organization, even if it's your own, it will be best for you in the end. Why do I so emphatic about it? I resigned out of the business three times because I did not believe that I was the right person for the job. And every time God graced me with a whole new thing, which enriched my life. So, secondly, you become even more significant if you start serving others, or if you promote that your business or your organization that you work for should start serving your environment. There are lots of opportunity in this country, like lots. Poverty is our problem. Education is our problem. Three, the ultimate high ground is if you can get yourself to understand that you are only an instrument in God's hand. It is He who does the job. If any one of you gets anything out of this talk today, it is Him, not me. That I have complete clarity on. So, since we're a bit in the building industry, I see it as a trowel. It's a good example. Most people understand a trowel. You cannot build this building without a trowel. But the trowel is not the architect, it's not the owner, and it's not the builder. It's just a trowel. So if you keep yourself nice, clean, and sharp, then the builder will select you and use you as an instrument. And never have any doubt about it. You are not the builder. You're just a trowel. But when the building stands and the winds come and it doesn't blow over, you have justification to feel good you played a role. And finally, or the third item, very important. I read once that A.J. Russell wrote, "Don't try to work for me," says God. "Don't you try to work for me. Live with me and for me. I am God, and I will do the work and determine the outcome." So it took us too long to realize that we've got the most powerful partner, in quotes, possible. Why not use him? So we do not take any shareholder type decision anymore without asking God. And we get an answer every time, and it is seldom within the timing that we expect, but always better. God, we need to know this by next Friday. No. So if you have the guts to wait, you will be rewarded. And finally, I just say again, the unlimited power of the key. So the final slide, the next one is, it can be, again, that one looks at this and you have your doubts. Not accept the things that come from the Spirit of God, but considers them foolishness. Because we are all human. I'm just pleading with you, if you want to read all about it, it is a very considered and complete report of what God did. And it appears to have a lot of value to many people. It's now reached 3 times bestseller status, and it's, I say again, it has no benefit to me. But what I hear and what the book does, and it's being used in courses all over and so on, it is really worth it. And please pardon me blatantly marketing it. It's simply part of my testimony. And thank you for your attention. I'm happy to take any question of any kind.
Before we take questions from the floor, we're going to just ask him a couple of other questions as well. So one of the things you mentioned in the book, I was reading it a couple of nights ago again, and one of the temptations we have, and you touched on it during the talk now, is that we like to hold on to things. One of your biggest changes happened the day when you stepped away, I'm not sure what the right word is, from Infotech, your first company. Very often that first company is your, you know, it's one's baby. But that stepping away, walking away, giving it away, sort of actually unleashed the potential of having many, many businesses later on. If you had stayed there, would have been one business, you would have been the CEO of a business like maybe many people. What advice would you be able to give people here? Because we've got people here sitting, maybe also leading businesses, but maybe inside your own life, God has called you to lead not one, maybe not 10, but maybe 20 or 30 businesses. What advice, what was the temptation, what was the struggle?
You know, I can only really repeat what I've already said, that it is the golden rule, and if there are 2 or 3 golden rules, this is one of it. Do what is best for the business. So let me explain it in this way. People have asked me, okay, so when did you get this calling from God? I never got a calling from God. I kind of fell into a calling, if you understand what I'm trying to say. The way you react to what it does becomes a calling. And I was never an IT guy. I don't even understand this nonsense that I spoke to you in the beginning. Bring your own teeth. Or I'm not on Facebook or nothing. So I'm not a techno-minded person. So when I started in the techno business, it was just an opportunity that presented itself at that time. Did I? Because I understood the technology? No. But a particular, and some of you may remember it, in those days, every second guy thought he was a techno marvel, so they demanded huge salaries and stuff. So the next thing was, we found it difficult to hang on to stuff, because they convinced themselves, the old man, I wasn't an old man then, I was nice and new. The old man who started this business, he's going to sit in the corner office for the next 50 years and there's no future here for us. So I resigned. Because I thought it was in the business's interest to show that there was movement. Now that was a little impetuous. And my wonderful wife, who passed away 2 years ago, I will never forget when I got home and said, I resigned today. She said, again. And that opened the way for the property business, which is a long story, you can read about it, which became the capital producer for the entire group. And God has this wonderful way of working on credit, it's not quite the right word, but working backwards. If he wants to achieve something because you trust him, ask him, whatever, today, then he brings things into play. And it's actually a fantastic story, and we don't really have time to go into the details now, but that is what happened. So I didn't plan to diversify. It's the way it was, because I did the right thing in terms of the few rules that I propagated.
Thank you. Franchal, another question that we often get is the Margon Trust and the way the trust works. And I remember one night when you came to speak at my house, one of the people asked you, how did you, they were sort of baffled with this thing. You mean you just sort of signed this away? You didn't keep everything for yourself. And somebody asked the question and said, why did you structure the trust in such a way that you even yourself cannot go back and take the money again? And it's your money, it's your businesses. And I think the answer was quickly, because you can't even trust yourself. Nobody can trust themselves. I remember it made a very big impact on my own life. Give us a little bit of advice just on the structuring of the trust. I know there's a whole document and maybe people who want it can get it. I know you've given it away freely, how the Margon Trust document looks like. What was the thinking, or what was the philosophy behind it? Why did you structure it in such a way that the money would just continue to freely be given?
Thank you. I've got one child, a daughter who's a chartered accountant and more. And still, I'm not exactly sure. I have the highest regard for her and so on, but as I sit here, I sometimes know that she does, but some other days I'm not so sure that she really grasps it, because it's too simple, you know, it's too straightforward. It's very simple. Why? I know, and maybe it's because it's only me that can know, because it's only me that was there. When I was facing bankruptcy and bankrupt, and by the way, please don't go and tell the people, the guy was bankrupt. I wasn't yet. You know, there's a difference. I was facing bankruptcy. So when I knew that the curtain had come down on the business, I knew it. I mean, you don't really have to be a brilliant guy to understand that. So, and I knew there was nobody to turn to. The bank manager down in Paul Kruger Street said to me, Leicester Buddy, do not come here again. I'm not going to give you more money. Understand it, go away. So, it's only me that really knew that I had nothing. So the simple answer is, I should have really given God 100% and say, okay, God, I'm not going to work for you. Please pay me properly, and that's it. But, you know, and I explain it a bit better in the book, but It's really a matter of what is there is not through my doing. Not. And I would have had 100% of nothing. And do you think I would have been sitting here if 2 weeks, 3 months, a year after that day in September 1980, I concocted a story in my own head that, you know, God really didn't help me. I was just sort of, I'm going to take the 30% back because he didn't really help me at all. It was my plan. I know it wasn't my plan. So I'm not sure if, please tell me, Mano, if I do not explain it properly, but it's simple. I found it easy to register the trust, lest I forget, to register the trust so that I can't take it back. Because the first lawyer told me, Lester, I understand these things, you don't. You write a trust that you can take it back. That's the way it is, and he insisted on writing. So I had no money, I had to pay him, and then I had to start saving for the next lawyer to do it properly, which I did. And so the trust is, we cannot cancel it. And point two, it's an independent trust, which SARS, bless their soul, accepted. And gave some benefits, tax benefits to it.
100%. Thank you, Francis. I think the temptation there for us as business people is so often to think, you know, we're trying to structure different structures, for example, trusts, and how to protect everything we have. And what I hear here is that Francois basically said, well, the only thing he needs to protect is the kingdom's advantage, the kingdom's whatever's going to flow into the kingdom. Let's open the floor for maybe one or two questions, given our time challenge.
I just want to find out how you made it known to the world that these are now kingdom expanding businesses. Was it only internal and operations, or did you also market or publish, or how did you make it known?
Thank you for the question. It's very important to tell you that we do not trade on God's name at all. Never. So the business never says, please buy from us, you know, we give the money to the kingdom. Never. Is that enough? Do you want more?
I would just like to know, I mean, many of us are responsible for growing our business, and it's often said that you need to surround yourself with good people and good leaders, and I think we all agree with that. But I would just like to understand is, how did that translate in your company when it comes to Christian people? I.e., I assume not everybody in your organization is Christian. In your leadership team, do you recruit for Christian leaders? Or, yeah, and I just recognize there's a tension there, because we say we're Christians here, and how did that work out in real life for you when you look at putting good people, is it Christian people, in your organization?
Thank you. By South African labor law, you may not ask somebody if he's a Christian or not, but even if we could, we don't. So there are 1,500 people in the business, and we do not enforce anything on anybody. So all the companies in the group there is no expectation, there's no pressure on anybody to appoint Christians only, and the business is run as a business. Obviously, the people in head office are much closer to the value system. So there's about 25 people in head office. So, you know, it's almost impossible to not buy into the value system if you want to be the financial director or whoever. So there are four top people. Peter Fora is the MD, and he's got four people with him. So it's just the way it is, you know, that we are known enough now that people who want to work there know exactly what it's about, or we tell them. But we never say, listen, you're a good guy, but you're not enough of a Christian, so you're not going to get the job. That guy is, that somehow sounds completely wrong. What we do have a lot of pleasure out of and gives us a lot of a big kick is that is to see that people who are really not believers in some of the outlying companies slowly warm to the whole idea, because we regularly tell them, like what I'm doing here now. Next week I'm talking to Merdek Marine's top management, who's considering an alliance with some people that we're not sure where they stand, and where they stand doesn't matter. But I tell them the story, so they are under no misconception that this is our value system. But obviously, the people working in the foundation, obviously, there are a number of trained pastors, I think 5, and other staff who are theologically trained people, like Danny and Etienne and people like that. And we have, at the head office in Stellenbosch, we have a prayer meeting every Monday morning, and other times if we need to have. So, but it's not forced on anybody, not at all. Did I answer your question?
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, sorry, I looked at the wrong person.
Yes, you just briefly mentioned in this last response the value system. Do you, as an organization, have stated values like many of our organizations have?
Well,
and what they are?
It's basically this Regni Negotia Extendimus, expanding the kingdom to the business. That is our number one value. But then we have no tolerance for the way some people are doing business, and I'm not pointing any fingers, but we do not buy business, never. In other words, corruption is a complete no. Like, people get fired, but I can't even remember when last it happened, but it's just not. So, discipline, we do not tolerate nonsense, like, we don't even have much staff parties, but let's say some of the things that go on in some working environments, the wrong guy goes home with the wrong woman, and stuff like that. Normal decency is maybe the closest I can get to you know, you can't have an organization like this and you dishonor God by allowing things that He will not be happy with. That's maybe the best way to put it. And somebody asked me this morning at another talk, do you ever fire people? Of course we do. Because, not because we like it, like Mr. Trump. It's simply because we have an obligation to do the best for the shareholder. And that is what, that is the key responsibility of a board of directors, to do the best for the shareholder. Now, we don't have any unclarity about who the shareholder is. So, if somebody is in a job, and the same with our kingdom partners, we give money to an organization, and the, you know, something goes very wrong in that organization, we terminate it. So you have to have some minimum discipline. Otherwise, it is not effective kingdom expansion. Effective is very important for us.
Well, Francois, just on your history, you said you weren't a techie. What did you do pre-Infotech?
I worked at Mobil Oil in the old days. I was a work-study officer. And then I became a systems analyst, which made me think I understand technological stuff, but it was a disillusionment on my part. And then I was a marketing services manager at a company of Anglo-American. And then at Arms Corps, I was internal management consultant, which sounded very, very grand. That's why I applied for the job, and that's how I emigrated from the Cape to here, internal management consultant. Little did I realize how difficult a job is to be a consultant. Nobody believes you and nobody wants to do what you... But it was a very rewarding experience. And later on I was a divisional manager for administration of the Arms Corps Group. So I was basically a middle manager when the war ended, the border war, and as the war wound down, this magnificent, dynamic, fantastic organization who was completely in the zone because of what they had to deliver for the war effort, whether the war was right or wrong is not the issue now, but they overnight became a nest of political inequity, people backstabbed each other and so on, because they realized that the ugly side of the human psyche came to the fore. I'm not going to lose my job, you're going to lose yours, because everybody knew the organization was going to become smaller. It didn't affect me, but I realized that, you know, if you're 40, when you're 50, you can do nothing about yourself. So on one sunny morning, I decided to resign, to force myself out. And I went home and I said to my wife, I resigned. And, you know, amazingly, she didn't run away or anything. But so I had I did a B in economics and an MBA. That's my whole story.
I just want to know, you say always put the organization in front of your own interests. Obviously, from a work perspective, you take the best action for the organization. How did you incorporate that in terms of family life to make sure that your work family life is balanced? Because now you've got to work maybe additional hours or additional time, putting the organization first in front of your family obligation or that interest of your interest in your family. How did you do that, being the high flyer that it was in the companies?
I'm not, and I never was, a workaholic, and I really believe in balance. Many younger people knew, because the younger, the more they want a quick recipe. One day I said to a guy in the audience, I get the feeling you want me to give you the one word that is going to be the success determinant. If you want to, it's faith. But faith in yourself, but faith in who you should have faith in. So I would say, if I can remember them, what I believe in is faith, momentum, a business, your division, the people you manage, there must be momentum. Consistent momentum every minute of every day. You must move. I believe in contra-intuitive daring. To go against the stream, but not be stream up. I can't think of the English word, stream up. to select the tide and understand where things are going now, and everybody sees it. If it's an easy to spot tide, everybody sees it. Now, then you must look in the other direction. And it doesn't work every time, but that's something I strongly believe in. In sharing with your staff, with partners, the more you grab for yourself, the less you have in the end. And balance, I said, discipline. I'm not a disciplinarian at all, but I believe in collective discipline. And you'll see in the book, I make a big thing about training and customer orientation, just to give you a taste. Many years ago in Infotech, when it was only the one company, the sales guys came and they said, you know, we're behind the times. We must go to a 4.5-day week. All the customers are gone Friday afternoon. We've got nothing to do. I said, fantastic. We can spend Friday afternoons training. Oh. And, so we spent Friday, I was reasonable. We said, okay, every second Friday you can go home 1 hour early. If the other Friday you stay half an hour later, so it was a reasonable deal. So we did collective training, not me standing here telling you, we all telling each other. And I can still remember vividly when the thought came from somewhere, we should get the non-salespeople to be more sales-oriented. So why don't you, the cost accountant, phone your counterpart once a month, or once in 3 months even, and say to him, these three things, and we'll tell you. So we would give them information like, we've just moved to a new building. Don't you want to come and see where we are? And that accountant that he phoned would love to get out of the office because he's been sitting worrying about the salespeople spending a lot of money gallivanting all over the country. So he said, yes, of course. So it was amazing how people would, I'm not going to phone anybody. I'm the accountant. No, the salespeople get a lot of commission. When we got them, convinced them to start doing it, it made a huge difference. Suddenly, that customer's accountant made sure that we are paid before we ask for the check and stuff like that. So let me not babble on, but there are all kinds of things that you can, you know. The book is half about my testimony and half about the business lessons that worked for me. It's just what worked for me. Whatever you can take out of it. And you've been a fantastic audience, and may God bless you in the rest of your course and in your life. All the best.
Thank you very much.